attention, the crowd. We are ready to go. And here comes Barnes out of his corner. You may see the twitches of the eye, the jerking of the neck. It's the Tourette syndrome that Amir Khan has had all his life. The pro golfer hoping to become Singapore's first ever homegrown world champion.
When I've asked him about it, he says he never takes his eyes off opponents despite it. The fans in here, they may have paid for the entire seat here at the Mall of Asia Arena, but they're only gonna need the edge of that seat tonight, Michael Spello.
A familiar team, Lakay, red trunks with the Filipino flag for Eduard Folayang, the former world champion. Left roundhouse kick out of southpaw stance for Khan. He's got the most knockouts in one championship history. Folayang's got that wushu style, those powerful side kicks. Amir Khan is a Muay Thai stylist.
Khan switches stances very well. He floats between southpaw and orthodox effortlessly. He mixes in a lot of different styles. Oh, look at Folayang spin already.
Both men coming close there. The high kick from Khan, the spinning back fist from Folayang. Outside low kick for Lyon. Needs to bring the hands up afterwards, not to get counted. Celebrated his birthday yesterday, Eduard Folayang. Will he be given the gift of reclaiming championship gold? Big outside low kick. There's the counter from Khan I spoke about. Folayang must keep his hands up when he strikes.
Jack came off very fast.
He can knock you out from anywhere. He doesn't need much room. Could knock you out in a phone booth. The Singaporean checks the low kick, goes with the counter down the center corridor.
Khan seems very content to stay in orthodox. He's timing his jabs nicely. He's closing the distance very fast with that right hand as well.
Khan, switch up roundhouse kick from the Singaporean. Inside leg kick misses the target. He loaded fully up on that, did Eduard Folayang.
Fully committed to these shots, Michael Schiavello. Without a little bit of distance, they blitz in, they blitz out. Oh, Khan goes after him, but look at that take down from Eduard Folayang. He's in the guillotine.
Good attempt, here from Amir Khan. He's on. Another bail, though. On the floor for the first time. 2:20 remaining, first round. Now back on the feet, out of the guillotine attempt goes Folayang. Throws a knee to the upper left rib cage of Khan. He goes down to the thigh. And once more to the thigh from Folayang. A real tussle against the wire here.
They've got 50-50 position. Each one has an underhook, each one has an overhook. Now, look for the knees. Watch Folayang's knees. He's an expert. His hips are back. He's pressing off the cage with his butt so he can create a little bit of space to deliver those knees. Now he's got Khan up against the cage.
Break off some room for Khan to work his high kicks back.
Khan looks to pack down a little bit of muscles since the last time we saw him. He's looking really thick.
Well, a little flicking back fist there as Khan was almost off balance. Front kick from the Singaporean. Folayang resets center of the cage. 1:25 remains now in the first round. We are set for five for the lightweight championship of the world. They clinch up again, drive Folayang back against the cage. Couple of knees off the right leg there from a former world champion.
Khan likes that overhand right as Folayang's missing it. Khan's lunging forward, throwing that big right hand. Folayang's been able to evade it so far. A little bit of time spent up that cage. The reversal by Khan is in the crowd.
Chance to get Folayang here in Manila, the sold out Mall of Asia Arena. It's one championship conquest of champions.
Nice knee landed by Khan, but you can see Folayang didn't like it. He's a little more cautious. Look at him guarding the hips with those hands.
Nice knee again to the midsection, trying to fold it in half like a piano accordion.
Was the plan of Khan. Go to the body early. Hurt him with push kicks and knees inside the clinch.
Some distance now for both men to get their strikes off. Who will land first with 20 seconds to go in the round? Front kick from Khan. Southpaw stance on the Singaporean. Looks for the inside leg, does Folayang. All right, cutting Wushu's side kick to the lead thigh. An outside crescent kick. A little left hand over the top. Combination. combination from Folayang. Spinning back kick, how do you do? There's the end of round one.
Wow, very close round. A lot of very, very close counters. You can see as one exchanges, the other one comes right back. The first part of that round was a lot of posturing, but look at this. Watch. Boom. Big leg kick landed by Folayang. Khan saw that counter. He's starting to counter very well with those punches. He's waiting for Folayang to kick, and he's attacking the head with the punches. Then he starts going to the body. He's watched that rear push kick from Khan going to the body, and then watch the knees inside the clinch up against the cage. Inside that clinch, you can see Folayang started to protect his body from those knees with putting his hands on Amir's hips, just so he create a little bit of separation and also judge that distance. The second round, watch for Amir Khan to increase the volume of kicks that go to the body. He might even start throwing in the roundhouse off of the switch.
Amir Khan said 100% I finish Folayang inside of three rounds. Folayang with this massive crowd behind him. Second round, the lightweight world title. Inside leg kick from the former champion. Alex round there, caught in the forearms. Folayang inching forward. Sets himself a lot lower in his stance than Khan. Good side kick, that one aimed to the liver section.
Khan's got to do something about that push kick. He's got to start stepping off to the side. Big left hook there, smack bang from Folayang.
And Khan does a quick count of his teeth. When Eduard explodes, Mitch, he can explode.
He comes out so fast. He throws that left kick. Look at that switch. He comes so
fast. Side kick to the midsection, but it's a little low.
Right. It looked a little bit low. It could have been seen as low, but Khan seems okay. Khan's not going to disrupt his rhythm. He's trying to find a rhythm. He's trying to disrupt Edward's rhythm. And he's okay.
Folayang looks like he's got a bit of pepper about him here in the second round. Throwing the strikes, got the output, got the work rate. Time for Amir Khan to pick up the pace now. Outside leg kick, missed the target from Folayang. Goes back to center cage, drifts off to his left. Stiff jab there from Khan. That was a beauty.
Like that jab, he's got to do more of that. He can't allow Folayang to start throwing target practice.
Folayang remaining high on the balls of his feet now. Looking very spry. Khan thrust the jab out again. Maybe needs a right roundhouse kick for company after that left jab. Beautiful Hushu kick again there from Folayang. Looks for the inside thigh, goes to the body, picks him up, tries to put him down. Khan maintains his vertical status.
I'd like to see Khan start going after the legs of Folayang. Start throwing those jabs and then just putting a little bit of a leg kick on, just so if this does go into the later rounds, four or five rounds, that, you know, the movement's not quite so explosive for Folayang, because he can do this for 25 minutes, no problem. Khan's got to slow him down. Go back to the body. He's getting away from his game plan.
Philippines currently own four world championships at one championship. Can Eduard Folayang make it five out of a possible eight? That would be an incredible national achievement. Switching stance again. Khan just gets out of the way. That wicked left hook of Folayang. It is sharp and fast. Inside leg kick from Folayang. Attention here inside the Mall of Asia Arena. You just get the feeling that at any moment something could happen. Plenty of action from Folayang. Little puppy rock hand on the inside. Overhook of that left arm from Amir Khan.
Momentum is starting to shift in Folayang's favor. Knees with the same amount of force because his hips are pressed up against the cage. Watch Folayang get pressed. throws the elbow. Beautiful timing on the spinning back elbow. Khan chooses to go airborne, flies into the air. Folayang snatches him out of the air and slams him to the canvas. What a round for the landslide.
Scenes of utter craziness inside the sold-out Mall of Asia Arena in Manila. Third round of five. Wherever you're watching in 138 countries around the world, in particular, all of our fans here in the Philippines on ABS-CBN Sports in Action, in Singapore on Octo Sports Toggle. On the edge of your seats, no doubt, cheering on these two tremendous martial arts warriors.
See, this is what happens. Eduard Folayang is starting to get more and more comfortable on his feet. Khan has to change the direction of this match. He's got to shoot him for takedowns. He's got to get Folayang to think about something else besides just the striking, because that is Folayang's world.
Here Khan trying to wind up the roundhouse kick. He's found so much success with it in the past. Third round of five. What is Khan thinking right now? He took some heavy strikes in the second round. A lesser man would have gone down, but not Amir Khan. Folayang tries for the overhand right. Khan taking his time. Tucks the chin, looks through the brow. Folayang skips in for an inside throat kick. Cutting side kick to the lead thigh there from Folayang, showing that wushu styling. What should Khan be looking for here, Mitch?
Trying to throw that big overhand right. Folayang saw it coming and was able to get out the way. Khan's got to spin around now, press him up against the cage, trying to take him down. He's only just standing there. He's gotten away from his game plan. He's not throwing the body kicks. He's not attacking the legs of Folayang. He's just now going headhunting with the punches. Khan's got to change things up a little bit. Look at this pressure of Folayang driving the head into the chin.
Khan climbs towards his corner, tries to pull the head down for the meet and greet knee. Both men reset. Under 3 minutes remaining in the third round. Khan goes high. Folayang goes low. Fakes there from Amir Khan, and the southpaw starts.
He's got to put some combinations together. Right now, he's just one punch, one kick. Folayang can see that stuff coming. You got to set him up.
Folayang, double forearms guard against the left roundhouse kick. This crowd has gone silent on the edge of their seats here inside the Mall of Asia Arena. Folayang lands again like he did in the second, they will raise the roof. Takedown for the former champion! To the feet goes Khan, trying to lock on a choke attempt. Puts out the head for Folayang. My word, Folayang is looking sharp. But there is still a long time to go. Khan has youth on his side.
Nice elbow from the clinch. He was able to connect with that right elbow.
Folayang showing that older age shall not weary him. Khan sets the left roundhouse kick here. Chose to go there. Rear hand instead. Switches stance now to orthodox as Amir Khan. Is he going to go the right roundhouse kick?
He's going to attack the leg with that kick.
Stiff jab. Tried to catch Folayang coming in. Folayang fakes up the lead. Gotta make sure he keeps his hands up here, Edward. Toe to toe now. Khan switches back to southpaw. Now back to orthodox. Trying to confound Folayang. Trying to mix it up, keep it fresh. Folayang bull rushes him back against the wire now. Throws a corking knee.
Control. Watch how Edward's controlling the left hand there of Khan. Khan, good circle out.
groomed throwing knees on the inside. This is how the round ends.
Eduard Folayang is starting to inch ahead. He found a lot of combinations that found success. Look at this, there was that punch coming. He was able to avoid it, goes right underneath, secures the very aggressive takedown from Khan. But Khan was able to scramble, trying to control with the front headlock, but Folayang was able to get back up to his feet. Again, look at that beautiful duck under, over the top, left hand. Folayang's mixing in the weapons well. Khan has got to change something he's doing. Right now he's only boxing. He's got to get back to the body kicks. He's got to attack the legs. He's got to mix things up a little bit. At least start to circle off, to create angles, and not just go forward and back. Folayang is really putting things together. He's mixing his kicks extremely well with his punches.
We go into what they call the championship round. The fourth of five for the lightweight championship of the world. Eduard Folayang. On the side of Khan. Experience on the side of the former world's champion, Folayang. Khan looks for an early takedown. Folayang stops the attempt. Right in front of our commentary position now. Right handle against the wire. Knee there from Folayang. Doubles up on it.
That's how good Folayang is in the clinch. Even when he's being pressed up against the cage, he still finds a way to create a little bit of space with his hips and throw those knees. Look at that. Three, four unanswered knees. Five knees now that have all landed to the body. Even inside the clinch, he's very dangerous with those knees because of those little subtle ways he's able to find that space and land those knees.
Muay Thai stylist Amir Khan would love to look on that Muay Thai clinch. Not going to happen at the moment, though.
Spinning back elbow. Every time he clinches up the cage, he lands the knees, softens up the body, and then Khan starts to drop his hands. Folayang spinning back elbow. Third time he's done it. Good job by Khan. Now he's starting to threaten the takedowns. But the takedown defense of Folayang is so good. He gets the underhooks, presses Khan up against the cage. Now he's attacking the legs for the takedown of his own.
And the inside thigh from Folayang. Looks for the horizontal elbow.
He's controlling the hand right here. Right, there's one elbow. Let's see if he spins. He can't spin because of the underhook on the left side.
Oh, those elbows slicing up. Amir Khan. Cut under the right eye of Khan.
See, now he can spin. Now he can spin with the right side. Yep. Chooses to go right up the middle.
Uppercut elbow from Eduard Folayang. It's all coming off the right arm of the Filipino. Tries to put the chin through the top of the head. The heavy artillery from Eduard Folayang. Amir's face showing the signs of those punishing Folayang elbows. Wants to sink a choke here on Folayang. Folayang puts the head up. Lands another left hook.
That's the biggest difference, Michael, that I've seen in Eduard Folayang so far is up against the cage. That clinch is doing damage up against the cage. This is a completely new element from Eduard Folayang. This is not something he's had. The way he's damaging little tiny shots. Oh, big head kick.
That's two high kicks in a row. The game terrifyingly close for Amir Khan. Folayang's got to keep that white glove glued to the side of his face.
That's not his style. He doesn't really protect that head. He likes to relax. He likes to flow. See how that hand keeps drifting down?
Folayang breathing a little heavier now. Fourth round of five. Gets out of the way of that high lift round. Slow down a little Folayang. Can Amir Khan capitalize? He's got the youth, Khan. Folayang sets the right hand here. Lifts off. Wushu kick to the lead leg. Circling into the power side, though, of Amir Khan. Folayang. he drew the shorts, cross, spinning hook kick. The acrobatics from Eduard Folayang. Thought about that side kick downstairs, 1 minute remaining, 4 for 5. Nice catch of the roundhouse kick there from Folayang. Southpaw starts here now on Amir Khan. Now switches back to Orthodox. Folayang, go watch those turnarounds. That's what Martin Nguyen caught him on when he got knocked out last time. Spinning back fist, duck under there from Amir Khan. What's the inside leg just for Folayang?
Let's see him shoot for a takedown. His guys, Folayang spinning, but he's doing such a good job at defending the takedown so far. Start kicking again. He's got to attack those legs. Folayang's movement hasn't slowed at all.
Spinning kick. Inside thigh kick from Folayang. What's a fusion? Final seconds of the fourth. We're going into the fifth. The deepest of deep water. Amir Khan has never been here before. Eduard Folayang has many times. How will that factor into things? Amir Khan never been to fight.
Let's watch Folayang do work up against that cage. The little subtleties that he's bringing to his game have completely changed. Watch this. He creates a little bit of space there with his hips, right? Boom, lands one knee. Boom, there's another knee. Look how he opens up the arm of Khan and lands those knees. Then he forces the arm down, gets Khan fighting the arm. Boom, comes right up top with a beautiful over the top. There's that spinning heel kick. Changes it up, changes the direction of the foot. So normally you throw the heel up, but then he hit it with the palm of his face. The three champions directly behind us, the strawweight, the bantamweight, and the flyweight world champions want another belt to take home to Baguio. Do they have enough space in their luggage, Michael Schiavello?
Here we go, the fifth and final round. Tension in the air. Philippines claim fifth world champion here at One Championship. Khan comes out of his corner quickly. Throws the high lift round. That's his prime weapon. Shoots him for a double. Sprawl out there from Folayang.
Takedown defense has gotten so much better. Khan's usually been able to take opponents down, but Folayang leveled up.
Wrist control, both men jousting for it. Spinning back elbow from Folayang. Then goes down to the thigh. Crossing elbow from Folayang. Overhook on the left arm for Amir Khan. Wants to sink a choke of the Filipino. Folayang defends against it. May break off. Let's see if Khan gets the roundhouse kick off the right leg here. Folayang drifting into it. Overhand right from Khan. Will Khan switch back to southpaw stance? There's the high left roundhouse out of southpaw, now back to orthodox. Shoots in, another takedown defense from Folayang, overhooks the right arm.
Takedowns and takedown defenses score the same, so Folayang is scoring with all these takedown defenses beautifully. It's that cage control we were talking about at the beginning. Folayang takes this match where he wants to. If he wants to keep it on the feet, that's where he does it. If he wants to keep him up against the cage, Folayang keeps him up against the cage. If he wants to keep it in the dead center, he's doing it.
Mitch Amir Khan's mouth open here. Is the younger combatant fatigued in the fifth and final round?
I believe so. Folayang has never gotten tired. Look at him, still throwing the heat with the feet.
You train at those high altitudes in Baguio City. One thing all Team Lakay has is cardio fatigue.
But not just training at high altitude, it's the work rate that these guys put out. It's constant. They do so much conditioning, so much training. They're such highly refined athletes in every sense of the word.
Nice elbow there from Folayang off the left arm.
Watch the elbow. See how he controls the hand? Boom, he pins down the hand and comes up with the elbow. Look at that.
Slicing and dicing with the elbows on the inside. The former world champion. 2 minutes 35 remains, fifth and final.
Those are little shots, but man, they are paying such dividends right now. He's controlling the clinch so well.
punch. Had to attempt there from Folayang. Khan's got to go, and he's got to go soon. It may be time to throw caution to the wind and pull out all the stops for Amir Khan. Folayang, ooh, that came close, a matter of millimeters. Jab there from Folayang, uppercut from Khan, and right hand from Folayang. Gets out of the way of the jab. Orthodox stance for Khan, who has switched the entire contest. Folayang goes to the outside lead leg. Spinning heel kick! That came close to shin. I should say heel to neck. And that connects. It's good night for Khan. Uppercut from Khan, nicely done. There's a jab from the Singaporean. Is he going to get his second win here with 1:30 remaining?
Fourth win right now, Michael. He's trying to push forward. He's trying to keep hunting. But look at Folayang going for the takedown. Good defense from Khan, though.
Khan stays vertical. We're moving towards the final minute of this world title bout. Khan glances towards his corner.
Elbow again!
Tried to shave the moustache off. 1 minute now. Are we going down to the judges, or will we see a finish in the final 60 seconds? It has been a champagne performance from Eduard Folayang. But Khan is not done yet. He will not wave the white flag. He will not go quietly into the night. A sidekick! Another one! Folayang, show you the wusha. Dropped out for a single leg, didn't have it. Pitches upstairs. Khan tried to pull the head down. Jab to Folayang. The hook afterwards.
3 seconds left.
Has Khan got a Hail Mary shot in reserve here? Has he got a big time flying kick? Eduard Folayang in the dying stages with the acrobat. Folayang bringing it home. Folayang with the side kick. Champion from the Philippines, Geje Eustaquio. see if Eustaquio can get off the wushu strikes early. Maybe look for a go-daddy knockout of the night. And will Akhmatov look to take him down and put Eustaquio on his back? Akhmatov surprised us last time, striking in the opening round with high roundhouse kicks and outside crescent kicks. At the moment, just seeing what Eustaquio has to offer, getting a feel of things, and also the feel of this heavily partisan audience all behind Geje Eustaquio here in Manila.
Geje looks really relaxed. I like how he's occasionally dropping his hands, because that's going to enable him to defend the takedown even better. He said earlier that he's not scared of the striking of Khairat Akhmatov. He needs to worry about the takedown. And by having his guard nice and low, he's going to be able to dig under the underhooks of Khairat Akhmatov or push the head down.
Akhmatov's been training at Tiger Muay Thai in Phuket alongside some of the best Muay Thai stylists on the planet to hone his striking skills. Let's see if they come to the fore here in the opening round. Fake there from Akhmatov. Nice cutting side kick to the lead thigh from Eustaquio. Fake from Akhmatov in southpaw stance here, the Kazakh in the white trunks. Edges forward, flips up a, you can't really call it a front kick, it was more of a pump kick there from the Kazakh.
Look at the movement of Eustaquio. He saw that coming and he just glided out of the way. It's like he slows down time. Pay attention to the head movement of Geje Eustaquio. It is so beautiful.
Really does get into the matrix sometimes. Geje Eustaquio evasive here in the opening round. Wushu stylist looking confident so far, Mitch.
I'd like to see him counter off that movement. Get out of the way, make him miss, but he's got to make him pay.
Side kick again to the lead thigh from Geje. Roundhouse kick. Akhmatov tried to catch it. Drags him to the canvas. Looks to take the back.
Beautifully done. Gets the body lock. Slides around to the back. Now he's working on the back control. He's going to try to slide his feet in underneath. Capture inside the hooks. He's got one hook in, but he's got also hip control here. He can still finish from this position without having both hooks in.
Eustaquio defending, as Akhmatov will slowly try and work his way to a rear naked choke here. But not if Geje has something to say about it. Eustaquio almost out of trouble. Gives his back again. And Akhmatov tries to sink the choke. Eustaquio back to his feet.
Geje scrambling well. But this is the cage control that I was talking about with Khairat Akhmatov. He dictates where this is taking place. Look at that body lock, nice and tight. Geje's got good scrambling, but he's not able to get away because of that control that Akhmatov has.
You are seeing the skills of one of the finest Greco-Roman wrestlers on the planet in Khairat Akhmatov. It's not Eustaquio's world down here. Geje wants to get it back to the feet, back to a standing position.
He's diving for a leg lock, though. He's going after it.
What a shot that would be! He could sub out Akhmatov! It would really bring the house down! Could he do it? It would be crazy!
Akhmatov is defending well. The knee's got to be a little bit deeper. Geje's got to pull the leg in. There's a heel hook here. Oh, he gives it up to get on top.
Eustaquio in top position. 1 minute remaining in the opening round. A seesawing battle. An absolute cracker.
Akhmatov has underhooks now. This is a good position. He can use this to bump out.
Not where a Greco-Roman wrestler wants to be, on their back, Mitch.
He's not used to train on his back, but Khairat Akhmatov is a seasoned grappler. He's very experienced in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, and he's going after the neck right now. Geje's trying to pass the calf guard.
Nice elbow just postured up momentarily for Geje, trying to open up the legs of Khairat so he can pass to side control on the left side of the Kazakh. You see Akhmatov locking down that left leg of Eustaquio.
He's trying to move. He's more just trying to control the posture. I don't think he wants Geje to posture up and start dropping the elbows in. So he's keeping his head nice and tight. And he's managing to survive out this round.
Elbows here from Geje Eustaquio to end the round. The ground and pound. Superbly done.
Interesting round. stand-up was almost negated on both individual standpoint, but then the grappling started taking to play.
Sellout crowd inside the Bowl of Asia Arena, and there's the champ, Adriano Moraes. You know that he is watching this contest closer than anyone.
Look at this. This was the leg lock game they started to play. You can see that Geje Eustaquio went after the knee bar, locks it up, throws it under his arm. It was close, but you can see how the knee is too far out. He was able to survive that. Then the scrambling where Geje was able to end up on top and put Khairat Akhmedov in a very uncomfortable position on his back. Brandon Vera, what do you got for him?
I got both of them under ground control. That's kind of where the difference is making up. First, Akhmedov looked really, really great. After that, Geje switched it around, and his ground control looked good. So we worried about the Greco-Roman wrestling and cage work ground control of Khairat, but we've seen Geje has improved.
But at this point in the match, if the match was stopped, who would you give it to?
Ready? Well, even on ground control, Geje's got striking superiority so far.
There you go.
Second round, set for five. Interim world title on the line. Geje Eustaquio in the red. Khairat Akhmedov in the white. His one championship. Global Superheroes live from Manila, broadcast to over 128 countries. We hope you're enjoying it. Eustaquio, who hasn't had a submission win since 2012. I know he'd love to get one back on his resume. Akhmedov looking very relaxed, very loose in the stand-up. Good inside leg kick. Swept out that lead leg of Eustaquio. Gut-munching knee there from Eustaquio. Akhmedov presses him back against the cage. And they break off. Eustaquio, high on the thigh, goes to the bread basket with the right hand. Mitch, what similarities, what differences are you seeing from this to the first encounter?
Well, now we're starting to see a shift in the tide. We can see that Geje Eustaquio is starting to control the superiority in both the ground, like Brandon Vera said, but also right now in the stand-up. If he can keep it here and really adjust his timing and his strategy, we can really start to see Geje Eustaquio take advantage or take control of this match.
We're definitely not seeing the comfort in the stand-up or the volume from Akhmedov as we did in the previous match.
Definitely had a certain sense of swagger about him, didn't like on those first three rounds. But now as we're in round five between these two high-level martial artists, we can see the way that Geje Eustaquio was starting to cut the angles, position Akhmedov up against the cage and start to unload some of these strikes. You gotta wonder, when is the double leg from Akhmedov gonna come into play?
Akhmedov in southpaw starts. Geje Eustaquio wants to engage that right hand down the center corridor. Public enemy number one of the southpaw is the straight right hand. Akhmedov edging forward. Geje looks to have that right hand cocked and ready and just throws down Akhmedov. Inside leg kick nicely placed from Eustaquio. There's the right hand down the tube. There's the lead hand to the bread basket. Certainly not seeing Akhmedov with the striking he had last time out. Ill-timed leg kick. Nice parry of the kick there from Eustaquio. What tactic do you see here from Akhmedov, Mitch?
He's trying to land strikes. He's trying to go after straight hands. I just landed a beautiful straight left hand there. He's trying to push forward, but Geje is so evasive in his defense. He's gliding and sliding out of the way and then countering now. He's getting more and more comfortable in there. Akhmedov's got to change things up. He's got to put Geje down on the mat and grind on him. That's what he's best at.
No attempts at a double leg and a body clinch. Any sort of takedown from Akhmedov here in the second round. We are seeing a glorified kickboxing contest between these two martial artists. A looping punch, then went for a double leg attempt with Akhmedov, but to no avail.
But you can see the low hands of Eustaquio is able for him to get these underhooks and keep Akhmedov away from attacking the legs. Now he's got him up in the upper body clinch. If he wins this, he can get away. This is a huge confidence booster for him, and he does just that.
That knee from Eustaquio almost folded him in half like origami. A big pickup, but didn't get the put
shoulders and let him up.
Eustaquio tried to catch him with the right hand on the way up. Momentum now with the Filipino. Eustaquio smack bang on the Cusa with the right. Then goes to the inside leg.
I like how he's attacking that inside leg. He should beat that leg up constantly, attacking that leg. Slow down Kairai so it's a stationary target. He's not threatening the double leg.
That right hand lead punch confounding Karen Akhmatov. Akhmatov loads up and left, that being the power hand of the southpaw.
Jay can't let Akhmatov get him up against the cage. Akhmatov likes to punch into the double leg. Jay has got to move around, get away from the cage, get his back away. That's it, press him up against the cage now, circle out.
Good elbow and a break off there from Eustaquio. Final 10 seconds of the second round. Confident round for Geje Eustaquio. Side kick to the knee, a little showboating. The bell sounds, and we go to the towns.
Without a little bit of a break dance there as he was transitioning out.
You spoke about the swagger that Akhmatov had in the first encounter. The swagger is with Eustaquio here in the rematch.
And we saw that on display at the very end of the second round. This is where Kairat's doing his best work. He's pressing Eustaquio up against the cage, getting that double leg and taking it to the mat. But when Eustaquio's out in the middle of the cage, he sees things from all angles and he's able to constantly move out of the way and counter. Brandon, what do you got for him?
That finesse that Geje has right now, his striking superiority is way ahead of Kairat's. Seems like Kairat's holding back, looking for the takedown, seems to load heavy shots, but he can't get off. Geje is so smooth right now. He can't get hit or be taken down. Kairat's panicking.
Third round, set for five for the interim championship of the world. In front of a sparkling, magnificent crowd, as always, inside the massive Mall of Asia Arena in Manila in the Philippines. Is Eustaquio inside the head of Karen Akhmatov?
I think at this point he might be inside the head. He's starting to really develop and show that confidence. He's able to stop takedowns, but he's got to stay away from the cage wall.
Now some delay here. They are looking for the mouth guard of Geje Eustaquio. You can see Akhmatov prowling back and forth. He cannot wait to engage in the action here, the Kazakh. A little more time for him to contemplate what strategy he'll come at with Eustaquio here in the third.
He's got to get it down. Plain and simple, he has to get this match to the ground, get Geje out of his comfort zone, and get to where he does his best work, and that's on time.
Are you surprised, Mitch, with all the time that Akhmatov has spent at Tiger Muay Thai since the last encounter, that he's striking? It does not seem to be as it was last time out. It's lessened.
It's not necessarily lessened. I just think he's having a hard time finding his rhythm because Geje is countering so well. He's moving. He's evading these shots. So Kairat's not able to establish his own rhythm and timing. He has to settle back down, find that, throw out those easy jabs, build his confidence, start connecting on some shots, maybe mix in some leg kicks. But he has to establish that rhythm that is so important for a striker to find, that confidence that you can hit your opponent.
Eustaquio taking his time, not rushing, not overextending himself. Plenty of instruction coming from the corner of Karen Akhmatov, right near our commentary position. No sense of desperation in that corner yet. Third of five. Inside leg kick there from Akhmatov. Body shot. Counter that took back agonizingly close for the Kazakh. Eustaquio tries to deliver that took. There's the outside thigh kick. There's the right hand. There's the outside thigh kick. Combination work now from the Filipino.
Beautifully done. Leg kick, straight right hand, back to the leg kick. The striking superiority is mounting up with every exchange. But look, as Kairat threw that big right hand, Geje wasn't anywhere near it. So the frustration has got to be extremely evident all over Akhmatov because he's not able to connect. He's not able to touch it. Look at that. Blue slides right out of the way.
Invasive. Great footwork, the hallmarks of Eustaquio so far in this contest. A confidence oozing, that almost Mona Lisa half smile from Geje Eustaquio, enjoying himself in there, knowing that maybe at the moment he's got the upper hand on Karen up the top, maybe knowing he's inside the Kazakh's head.
Every single takedown, Geje is able to stop, his confidence levels up. We're seeing a whole different Geje Eustaquio. The striking is starting to flow. Look at that, slides out of the single leg attempt. Chiron's got to pressure up against the cage.
High knee from Eustaquio. Crowd oohs and ahs and gnashing of teeth every time he comes so close.
But look at that, Geje is able to turn Chiron around and press Chiron up against the cage, push away like it was nothing. That's huge, Michael.
We are seeing an exquisite round so far from Geje Eustaquio. The Filipino doing everything right. Is there some frustration creeping in on Karen Akhmatov now? The Kazakh resets, but we haven't seen him with the aggression. We haven't seen him with the cage control in this round.
Geje Eustaquio has never been into the championship rounds. Khairat Akhmedov lives in the fourth and fifth round. He excels in those rounds. But we're seeing the confidence of Eustaquio just shine through. We're seeing the best gravity we have ever seen in one championship.
Is there any sign here, Mitch, of a deep water strategy from Akhmatov deliberately?
Man, it's hard to drag the Baguio City fighter or athletes into deep water. They train at altitude. Their conditioning is their best trait. These guys got gas tanks that are the size of semi-trucks. They know how to put in work, and conditioning is almost never a factor for them.
Jab there from Eustaquio. Eustaquio using his angles, and once again, the evasion. He is in the matrix tonight with his defense against the strikes of Akhmatov. Anything in this choke image?
It might be there, but Geje doesn't seem too concerned with it. He looks okay. Karat's got a good squeeze. He's finished with chokes before.
Look at the bicep bulging, the deltoids also. A little Karat Akhmatov, such a powerful Kazakh. Eustaquio surviving. Olivier Coast right on top of the action.
Khairat's got 10 wins by choke, so he's definitely very comfortable going after the neck. But look at Geje pressing Khairat up against the cage.
10 seconds remaining. Eustaquio surviving the choke attempt here from Karen Akhmatov.
This is when the support of the Filipinos is going to come into play. When Geje hears this electric crowd spur him on, he can dig deep inside himself and find a whole nother level. Look at that. Ends on the right hand. And then when Chiron had the, this is a takedown. Look at these takedown attempts. He said it was the key to the match. Who can initiate the takedown or stop the takedown? And Geje is stopping the takedown.
Brandon Fura, you've been here before. How much of an extra weapon is the crowd when they're on your side in the Mall of Asia Arena?
Here, this crowd here in the Philippines, when they're behind you and they're pushing for you, you don't get tired. You breathe in their energy and push out electric. It's amazing to watch these athletes go at it. And I have Geje pulling ahead and strike his spear during this match. He's just pulling away.
The striking superiority was jumping off of the screen there for Brandon Vera's scorecard.
We are ready to go. Fourth round, penultimate round of action. It is still anyone's for the taking. You cannot write off Karen Akhmatov. We saw towards the end of the third round, he can still slap on a choke.
You gotta wonder, has Geje done enough in the first three rounds? Can Chiron come back from this hole? According to Brandon Vera's scorecard, Geje's light years ahead of Akhmatov. This is where this is going to be very important. Akhmatov's trying to pressure up against the cage. Is he going to shoot him for a takedown?
All it will take to turn the tide, to swing the pendulum, is for Akhmatov to body clinch or shoot him for a double leg and put Eustaquio on his back. But it hasn't happened yet. He's got to get Eustaquio on the ground.
He does, but now he's got him pressed up against the cage, but he's not shooting for the double. Geje is good to get his back off the cage. He can't get pressed up against the cage like this.
In the first encounter, we saw these inventive outside crescent kicks and head kicks from Akhmatov. They're not apparent tonight.
He just doesn't have the same sort of confidence that he had in the first one to throw those, because Geje has been able to stop all of his takedowns, not take a lot of damage, and land strike after strike.
Dead center of the cage. Southpaw versus Orthodox. Let's see the right hand from Geje. He throws it. Akhmatov backs him against the fence.
See if Geje can spin him around again. He's got the body lock.
Pulled it.
Just that.
What does that say for the condition of Akhmatov the moment that Geje can spin him around so easily?
It's the strength factor. Geje is typically, you know, more of a finesse guy. He's able to improve so much in strength and conditioning that he's able to out-grapple the Kazakh up against the cage.
And he landed a beautiful Muay Thai elbow to the hairline of Akhmatov just moments ago. Akhmatov trying for a two-punch combination of his own. But Eustaquio, you feel, is in the groove, in the moment, seeing what's coming from the Kazakh and responding. He turns him again, throws an elbow, breaks off everything right from Geje Eustaquio.
We are seeing a whole different game. The takedown defense has been the key to this match. He's able to stop the takedown, but also in the clinch as well. He's controlling Kairat up against the cage.
A 6-week camp for Geje Eustaquio. Said last time out, I let Kairat dictate the match too much. I'm not going to do it tonight. I'm going to dictate the pace. I'm going to dictate where it goes. I'm going to apply the pressure. And indeed, he is living up to his word so far.
There has to be some desperation coming from the corner of Akhmatov. He has to start increasing the speed at which he's throwing these shots. He's got to let things go because we're getting real close to the end of the fourth round here. There's one of those kicks we're talking about, though, Michael.
Finally, maybe the inventiveness of the striking coming back into play for Akhmatov. Now he's getting the legs up on Eustaquio. Eustaquio's little shimmies, his little pivot, his quarter angle turns. They've been superb. They've been sublime for the Filipino tonight. Here's the jab again. That pouring, roving jab to set the right hand. There's another side kick off the lead leg. A wushu favorite. Roundhouse kick to the forearm. Side kick to the thigh again.
The legs really well, and maybe that's factoring into a lot of these takedown attempts. Kairat might just not have the strength or the support in that lead leg.
Two-punch combination. Should have gone for four or six there, you feel, Kairat Akhmatov. Southpaw edging forward. Eustaquio resets. Eustaquio going clockwise into the lead hand of Akhmatov, which is where he wants to go against the left-handed athlete.
1 minute left in the
fourth round. Wild looping punch from Akhmatov. Tries to transition to a double lead. Crowd momentarily thought Eustaquio had a choke attempt.
Kairat has been the distance twice. He has been the full five rounds with the champion, Adriano Moraes. But now, have we seen Geje Eustaquio in these championship rounds? The answer is no. This is a new territory for him. Look at it throwing on the guillotine.
Breaks away from the clinch, throws an elbow, and backs away.
Here's Kairat, does some good work up against the cage, but look at Geje just sliding out of the single leg attempt. Beautifully done. And there's a submission attempt from the gravity, Geje Eustaquio. Kairat's able to defend it off, but now we're in round five. Brandon, quick word, what do you think?
The aggression of Geje is increasing the striking superiority. Kairat's behind on all categories. He needs to do something big if he wants to win this belt.
Does he still have a chance? Can Kairat dig deep and come away with the win?
This is MMA. There's always a chance. This is mixed martial arts. There's always a chance of something happening in this match, even at the very end, in the last round of the bout.
5 minutes remaining. This massive crowd behind Geje Eustaquio. What has Akhmatov got left? What tricks does the Kazakh warrior possess? And will we see Eustaquio employ the right hand? He said he'd knock out Akhmatov with the straight right. And it's Akhmatov who launches the heavy artillery early. Sidekick, it's worth a treat for Eustaquio all night. Outside leg kick. Good left hand, just needed a little bit more mustard behind it to Akhmatov.
Geje felt that, he rattled his head back. That one landed cleanly. I wish you could see him follow up with that. Throw a leg kick behind that big left hand he's throwing.
Body shot from Geje Eustaquio. Now we'd love to have the gold here in the Philippines and set up a showdown with Adriano Moraes. Fake there from Akhmatov. Akhmatov does have punching power. One big salvo could turn the tide here.
You can see that Kairat is starting to land shots. He's starting to, you know, pick things up a little bit. Maybe that, the final round, is he sensing that urgency?
Or like we said, Mitch, could it be a deep water strategy all along from Kairat Akhmatov? He's looking the best of the striking now that he has throughout the entire contest.
Very true. Jehe's slowing down a bit. This is Kairat's chance to really put it on. Geje.
Body shot there to the sternum from Geje Eustaquio. And Akhmatov fires back. A lot of speed, a lot of power in that overhand left.
Geje stepped on the foot the same time that he threw that punch, causing Kairat to lose balance. I like the strategy.
Center of the cage, neither man willing to give it up. Right hand lead, outside thigh kick, clever combination from Eustaquio.
I like the way he punctuates each combination by throwing that leg kick.
Threads the right hand between the double forearms, jab to right, the old 1-2 kangaroo. Body shot there from Akhmatov. Curl they took over the top from the Filipino. He's answering everything now. From Eustaquio. The corner of Akhmatov, but it's out there, man, to go, to pull out all the stops, to throw caution to the wind. Beautiful evasion from Eustaquio, lands in there. This is a treat to watch. Geje Eustaquio at the height of his martial arts powers, Mitch.
Good combination by Kairat to come in there with that straight left, put a hook behind it. But he's got to increase. He's got to go for the finish. He's got to go for broke in the last 1 minute and 40 seconds of round five.
Checks the inside thigh kick. There's Eustaquio. Staring down the barrel into the eyes of Kairat Akhmatov. He's beaten him physically so far, we feel. Also, perhaps psychologically tonight. Time is ticking down for Akhmatov. 1:15 remains. Again, this crowd starting to bubble, starting to simmer. They're feeling it. They know their man is in sight of the gold. Under a minute remaining now. Akhmatov's got to pull out the stops. He cannot hold back any longer. Eustaquio dancing, overhand right. There's a counter shot from Akhmetov. And again, no mustard from the Kazakh. 35 seconds now. Eustaquio's confidence oozing out of every pore of his body. 25 seconds for Akhmetov to find something. There's the left hook. It's going to require a Hail Mary shot now from the Kazakh. He picks it up. He drives it down. But what can he find in 10 seconds? He's going to find a submission, but he's not going to get there. Eustaquio takes some elbows for his trouble, but he's going to see out the round. We go to the judges. And this Filipino crowd senses they're about to have a champion.
Wow, what a time for the greatness to be realized inside of Geje Eustaquio. In his world title challenge, he brings out the best gravity we have ever seen. His head movement, his takedown defense, the superior striking was on display tonight in his home. Was it the crowd? Was it Geje? Maybe it was everything, but beautifully done by Geje Eustaquio. But Khairat Akhmetov put up a tremendous challenge. But as I'm looking at Brandon Vera's scorecard, the numbers are going crazy for the red corner. Brandon, what do you got?
It's amazing. You know, Geje said from his last fight to this one, he doubled his workload. It showed tonight. His striking superiority led to his relentless aggression, which led to massive damage on Khairat. And I think that's what took it out of him during the fight.
The great Enzo Gracie is in the ONE Championship cage to present the bout to our victor. What a treat to have Enzo Gracie, one of the greatest to ever do it, here at ONE Championship tonight to present to our interim champion. We saw a completely different breed of martial artist in Geje Eustaquio tonight. Amadea says the belt stays with him. He'll take on, no doubt, the winner of this one. Let's go to Dominic Lau.
Ladies and gentlemen, presenting the World Championship belt is the martial arts legend, Enzo Gracie! And now, after five rounds of battle, we turn now to the judges' scorecards. All three judges have scored this contest in favor of your winner by unanimous decision. And now, the ONE interim flyweight world champion, Geje Eustaquio.
My championship of the world, Michael Chiavello, Mitch Chosimukian, Balignon in the red, Fernandez in the black. It may very well be the raw power of Balignon, the finesse and technique of Bibiano Fernandez.
You see Kevin throwing that lead hook. That's how he sets up that spinning kick. He's looking for the spin early. Bibiano testing the leg right there.
We saw the turning back kick to the liver of Andrew Leone. One of the most spectacular kicks we've ever seen. It sent Leone a full 10 feet across the ring on that night. It was the beginning of the end for Leone. And there it is from Balignon. Turning back kick to the liver.
That's one to the body already.
Jab from Balignon. Outside fly kick from Bibiano. Looking to drop down for a single leg there, the Brazilian. Balignon saying he received a groin strike, and a moment's break here called by referee Olivier Cox.
You can hear the
certainly the aggressive start though from Kevin Balignon here, Mitch. He's turning early, he's trying to line up the power salvo.
That's what he said, he wanted to attack the body. This is the exchange. Bibiano went low right there as he was attempting an inside leg kick. He went back up, a flurry of punches.
punches. He was looking for the takedown. Takedown wasn't there. It came over the top. Did tap the groin.
Just a caution there from our referee, Olivia Ghost. Accidental groin strike, of course, but he hit the groin and the pain receptors kick in. So a moment to recover here for Kevin Belingon, who's already showing his hand very early on in this world title match. We can see the game plan here of Kevin, as you said, to go to the body of Bibiano Fernandez. They believe that's the weakness. They believe that's the chink in the armor of Bibiano Fernandez.
This is how he likes to set up, right there to the low, right there. No denying that it happened. You can almost hear the crack of the groin right there. But Bibiano shakes it off, and the toe that he is, ready to put in work.
They recommence here in the first round of action. Look for the body work again from Belingon, the man with the flowing mullet. Fernandez, the bantamweight champion, the greatest champion in ONE history. Never beaten here in ONE.
He's got that reach advantage. Let's see him throw out that jab. So testing distance.
Oh, he just put Bibi on the jaw with that short left hand. Bibi dropping low levels to try and lock onto a leg to take down Belingon. Belingon does not want to go to the ground with Fernandez. Fernandez, double leg here, trying to get the Filipino down. Belingon not going there, however. Body shot from Belingon.
This would be a good first test for Kevin Belingon's takedown defense. He looked stellar against Martin Nguyen in the takedown defense, but Bibiano is a different breed of grappler. Look at him attacking the legs. Look at Kevin. Good defense so far. He's got to be careful. That's where you want to go.
Inside of half guard here. Bibi Fernandez, top position, peppering palm strikes to the side of the head of Kevin Belingon. Now Belingon finds himself in Bibi land. How does he defend against the several submission attempts and the ground and pound that Bibi can bring from these positions?
First thing he needs to do is take that right arm and start looking for an underhook. In half guard position, if he can get an underhook underneath the left arm of Bibiano, he's going to be able to turn onto his side. Now he's got the arms trapped on the other side, so he's got the half guard on the other side. That's what he needs to start doing. He needs to get one side on the underhook. Because right now he's got his half guard on the left leg of Bibiano and the underhook on the other side, the right side of Bibiano. So he's kind of trapped himself in this position. Bibiano can apply pressure with his shoulder and look to pass the guard. Kevin needs to create movement in this space. It's only to give Bibiano the opportunity to start setting things up.
Fernandez, a BJJ sensation, five-time world champion, three-time Pan American champion, has won 11 gold medals in elite BJJ competitions around the world. It's been an aggressive start from
Bibi. Don't run the fence, guys. Don't run the fence.
Try to finish a quickly trying to take Belingon into deep water. Fernandez has a proven gas tank. He's gone five rounds, five times in his career, winning all five times by decision.
No technique on the escape right there. Pure explosion to get out of the half guard there, Bibiano Fernandez.
Three sets here. This Belingon has power in the legs. Oh, turning back kick to the liver. And then he goes for the head. He tries to take his head off. The headache maker for Belingon. He's put the power early. And Fernandez looked a little shocked momentarily. Especially when he's been hit in the head. There's another turning back kick to the liver.
He was right. They are definitely going after the body with that spinning back kick. And look how fast he comes out of that. There's almost no setup. He's not even throwing that hook. It's just an explosion into that turning back kick.
The liver, a very large organ in the upper right portion of the abdomen, highly vascular area. A shot to the liver can be excruciatingly painful. Martial artists say the most painful way to get knocked out is with a liver shot. Turning back to the liver again there from Belingon. It's about the size of a football, the liver, right side of the body. Mostly protected by the rib cage, but still slightly exposed. And if you dig in between the 9th and 10th rib, you hit that vagus nerve, it can close down the entire body. That's what Belingon's looking to do with his turning back kick. There's one from Bibi Fernandez. But my word, what a start here from Kevin Belingon. He went
position. That was spinning back kick, landed not close to the liver, but up top a little bit. That one was hunting again after it. He is repeatedly going after that. But that up top kick was a beautiful spinning heel kick. Papiano high on the guard, veteran that he is, caught that.
I was going to mention play coach for a moment. If you take Lakay, what are you telling him about Belingon?
Kevin Belingon is putting things together beautifully right now. Their game plan is working to the T. I'd like to see Kevin Belingon set that up a little bit, throw the jab, get him thinking about the hands first. Get Bibiano lift his hands up, then spin to the attack to the body. Bibiano, he's got to move forward. He's a little bit tentative there in the last couple, about 90 seconds of that first round. He started to slow down a bit. He was watching careful to the body.
Ready?
Likes to Bibiano throw the hands and start to chain wrestle with him. Back Kevin up against the cage and take him down and grind on him.
Singapore has been a happy hunting ground for Bibiano Fernandez. It was here in 2013 that he won the title. To unify the one bantamweight world title by Benny Sutil Kim. A good right hand stiffly there from Belingon. Bibi tries to thread the right hook. Bibi backs it up with the right hand. Double leg down from the Brazilian. Gets the takedown and then back in Bibi land. The half guard position. Let's see what Fernandez can do. The takedown has come early in the second round.
And when it was set up with the hands, he was able to utilize the boxing, back Kevin up with the big right hand, get him up against the cage, and now he's grinding on him. Now Bibiano's gonna start to slowly and methodically work on Kevin. He's gotta slow him down a little bit. He's gotta get Kevin to expend some energy. Kevin is extremely explosive. That's how he got out of the first exchange here on the ground. He was able to just throw Bibi off on him.
Let's go, guys,
the explosion, the fast twitch muscle fiber of Kevin Belingon is at an all-time high. Bibiano needs to slow him down.
It's gonna serve well mentally for Kevin Belingon that he's out of the first round. Last time they met in 2016, Bibiano tapped out Belingon with a Kimura in just 4 minutes and 4 seconds. Here he is in the second round, and Belingon told us, I'm a completely different martial arts machine than I was last time we fought.
Every single one of Team Lakay always excels in the rematch. They go back, they've got their head coach who breaks everything down, and they always find a way to be much more successful in the second time.
Fence.
When they run it back, Team Lakay, second team.
Now we run 19 and 5, 11 finishes, including 8 knockouts, 9 of those in the very first round. Scramble here. Belingon back to his feet. Seems to be overwhelming Filipino support for Kevin Belingon in the crowd here in Singapore tonight. But again, he exploded out of the technique. And the chants go up for Kevin Belingon, the underdog here in Singapore. Gets out of the way. What a matchup for the bantamweight championship of the world. It's one championship, Heart of the Lion, live from the Singapore Indoor Stadium. Got the right hand cocked and ready here, Belingon. Shifts off to his left. Bibi dead center of the cage. Jab there from Fernandez. Belingon taking his time. Very patient match so far from Belingon. Overhand right misses.
Everything Kevin throws is full force. There's no waiting out process, no setup. Everything is just one big shot trying to take that head off of Bibiano Fernandez. But good eyes from the veteran. He's moving out well. And so Kevin is extending.
Been half a foot off the ground there. That was incredible. Take down there from Fernandez. Now the Brazilian up the intensity, up the aggression, takes the back of Belingon. Here's Bibiano. This is what Fernandez does so well. The body triangle locked on. And Belingon's got no place to go. Belingon could be in trouble here. Bibiano goes for the arm.
Kevin Belingon pushed the leg off of Bibiano as
Mitch, at any point here, do you feel the Belingon is going to the well one time too many, hunting after that turning back into the liver, that it may become predictable and BB may start to fueling time off it?
He's probably up near the double digits in attempting that spin kick. Bibiano's seen it, but he's got to avoid it. He can't take it over and over again. He's going to start to wear on it. And Kevin is throwing everything with full power. So you can see Kevin starting to slow down too. And listen to this crowd.
Going to get a change out. 1:49.
Interesting. Bibiano could have went into side control, but he chose to shove the legs between his legs, trap him, and slowly try to work his way into mount.
Let's go, guys. Work.
Tremendous contest. In front of our Chinese commentary team across the country. Top position, Kevin Belingon. Hope you enjoy the place. Hope you live in 138 countries. They're live and free on the One Super Act as Bibi Fernandez mounts Kevin Belingon.
And Belingon's got 45 seconds here. He's got to hold on tight to those arms, but now they're starting to be sweaty. So Bibiano slid the arm out. Now he's going to go. Look how he has that left arm there. He's nice and high. Kevin's got to pull him tight. It's a bad spot to be in, though. This sets up an armbar. Watch his knees. If he chooses to go high, oh, he goes flat. Applies the pressure there. Now he's. I think this is a ground and pound position right now.
20 seconds remains. Third round.
That's the veteran right there, Bibiano. He knows that they're slippery right now, so Kevin could pull out of an armbar. So he chose to go heavy hits and soften him up and end the round in a very dominant position.
Postures up now, Fernandez tries to drop the ambulance on the head of Belingon. Sneaks in the right hand, three down, two to go.
That's a veteran move right there. He chose to not risk losing the position by going after the armbar. He flattened his hips out, softened Kevin up a little bit, went high right as the bell was about to ring, and just let the punches come down. And that, you don't go round by round, you go by the match in its entirety. But that is a great way to end 15 minutes right there, Mr. Spello.
Star-studded Chief Lakay in the corner of Kevin Belingon. The landslide, Eduard Folayang, who in a few weeks' time in Manila will take on Amir Khan for the World Lightweight Championship. There's Bibiano Fernandez. We know he's seen it all before.
Fast and hard.
Do you feel that Fernandez underestimated Belingon at all, Mitch?
No, I don't think so. I think he's seen the past six matches. I think he's seen the improvements that Kevin's made, but he's also extremely confident in himself, and he knows the type of martial artist that he is, the type of athlete that he is, and also the type of strategist that he is. Everything that he's doing is very methodical at this point. These are the championship rounds. This is where Bibiano lives and breathes.
Let's go, guys.
The penultimate round. Jab in from Belingon. Jab from Bibiano Fernandez. Heel kick from Belingon. Hang close. Try to bring the heel to the temple. Cutting Wushu's side kick to the knee there. Coming Colonial Nord just above the knee. Jab from Belingon to put down the points. Fernandez jab two, didn't have the stops behind it though.
And he still landed on Kevin. And that's what's given him a little bit of just success in the stand-up, is he still lands with these shots. And what that's gonna do, it's gonna create an opening for him to just like that, throw that overhand right, change levels, and go after those legs.
Two absolute warriors who have overcome a lot of adversity early on in life. Fernandez almost dying from malaria, contracted in the Amazon jungle, where he was fending for himself and hunting and gathering as a seven-year-old. Belingon had to go through some loss of family members, raiding of bandits in his childhood home in the Philippines. Abject poverty. Here they are, both men, in the main event at the top of the martial arts world. Championship here in Singapore.
Up to finish.
Jumped over the half guard there, landed in
inside control. Kevin starts to look a little bit fatigued. This is not something we're used to seeing. That's that explosion that we're talking about. You can't explode out of like that. You have to make sure you're technical. You still got to maintain that technique, especially with a grappler like Bibiana Fernandez.
Once again, we are in the deep theater. As I said earlier, Fernandez, five times in his career, has gone the full five rounds on all of those decisions.
Want to finish?
Doesn't look like Belignon's gas tank is slowing at all, even though he is the older statesman here. Side control for the Brazilian. 2 minutes 35 remaining, 4th of 5. The bantamweight championship of the world. From Belignon, trying to open up a cut perhaps. Cuts in the hip a little here from side control, does Fernandez. The media attention surrounding this main event all week here in Singapore. It's been extraordinary. So many photographers and reporters from newspaper, radio, television, websites. Some groundbreaking news released in one championship this week.
Let's go, one to finish.
And we are seeing a fitting main event. Looks for the full mount as Fernandez steps up the back and tries to take the arm. And once again, Belignon is free. And this crowd loves it. Another escape from Belignon.
Hard to finish an armbar this late in the match. They're so slippery, easy for them to pull out. But Belignon, once he gets a hold of that arm, he can stay tight with it. But Kevin is still so explosive, he's able to just power out of these shots. Or these attempts at submissions.
125 on the clock now. Bibiano's gotten Belignon to deep water. You see that the aggressive striking is not fair as it was in the opening two rounds from Belignon. It's still dangerous as ever. It's a demoralizing mix, but Bibi's trying to down last one of securing them.
Not so much. I don't think he's demoralized. I think he's trying to figure out another solution. You can see him inside the side control, and he didn't want to give it up, but he's trying to finish. Bibiano is not the lay and pray. He's not going to stay there and just hold the position. He's going to try to finish you. He loves to finish his opponents, and he's always going to be looking for it. He made that as a calculated risk. It didn't pay off, but that's Bibiano Fernandez for you.
Fernandez controlling since
30 seconds
in the fourth round. Undefeated since 2010, Bibiano Fernandez. And what great names he's picked along the way. Antonio Banderas, Yoshiro Maeda, Koichi Okazaki, Sutro Kim, Ueda, Daehwan Kim, Tony Taru, Chris McCullough. Of pundits did not think it would get this far. But here we are, inside the sold-out Singapore Indoor Stadium for the Bantamweight Championship of the World. Who will prevail? They touch gloves. Outside leg kick from Fernandez, the champion. Outside leg kick again. What tremendous heart, what aggression, what power from the interim champion, Kevin Belignon. Turning back elbow from Belingon. All right, Mitch, with 4 minutes 30 remaining, what does Belingon need to do?
He's gonna have to land big. He's attacking that leg beautifully. See how Viviano's limping a little bit on that leg? I think these things are starting to build up for him. But what's he doing? He's setting up that spinning back kick. He's gonna keep going to the well. He's gonna keep looking for that power. What it's gonna do is gonna get Viviano to drop his elbows down to his body to protect the body shot. What's that gonna do? That's gonna open up the head. Kevin Belingon can still come over the top with a beautiful right hand. Viviano needs to work the jab. Needs to work the jab, set up that right hand, and look for the takedown. Put Kevin on his back and grind on him for the next 4 minutes. But he's got to get at least 2 minutes on the ground in a dominant position.
Time is ticking down. Fernandez sends a cut. Inside leg kick to a right hand. Good combination for Fernandez. Jab there from Belingon. Belingon looks for the outside lead leg. Can't find it. Lots of swelling around the brow of Kevin Belingon. Damage to the bridge of the nose of Viviano Fernandez. High kick from Belingon. Fernandez saw that one coming. Jump turning back kick. Bon Jovi style. Shot to the heart. Bibby resets. Will one of these two men put their foot down and go for it? Throw caution to the wind. Hell for leather with 3 minutes remaining. Is it time to pull out all the stops? Leg kick there from Belingon. Angles to the inside thigh.
Michael, at 20 minutes, I had Viviano slightly ahead, even though he was knocked down by that right hand. But at this point, Kevin is starting to inch forward. He's starting to land these strikes. He's starting to outstrike Viviano Fernandez. He's starting to connect more.
You wonder if with his experience, Viviano may be trying to go kleptomaniac and steal them in the final minute or so. Jab from Belingon. This one's close. There's no doubt about it. It could turn any moment.
This is an extremely close match. I think it might come down to the last 2 minutes. Either way, right now Kevin's starting to find his rhythm. He's starting to land shots. Viviano found his right home for that right hand just now.
Inside leg kick from Belingon, nice and high on that inside thigh.
There's a scoring, Michael. That's like the fifth one that's landed this round.
Belingon has been putting down the score with the striking here in the fifth. Bibby's got to change it up now. Got to go for something. Either the strikes or look for that takedown. Jabs from both men.
I think he needs a takedown. He doesn't want to stand here with Kevin lighting him up. That's what he goes after. Oh, Kevin gets away from Viviano Fernandez. Can he do that for another 90 seconds to keep on his feet? Keep going after that low inside leg kick.
Again from Belingon, no doubt he's won the strike in this final round. Jab from Belingon. What does Fernandez have left? He tries to catch him, but it's not catching him.
He's got to set that up better. He's got to throw those hands. He's got to get Kevin lifting up his hands to protect the head and then shooting for the takedown. Nice leg kick.
Captures a leg kick with a right hand from Belingon. Breaks the jab, does Viviano Fernandez. Under 40 seconds now. Leg kicks again from Belingon.
30 seconds left in the
This is Belingon's world, man.
And we've heard the crack of Belingon. On the back foot and out striking Fernandez. Fernandez has come forward. Belingon misses with the leg kick. 15 seconds now. Is there one big salvo left in there? Hail Mary shot. Final 10 seconds. He believes he's won it. And there it is. We're going down the top of it in Singapore. What a match.
go into judging this matchup. The striking superiority of Kevin Belagov, the shots landed by Viviano Fernandez, the top control, the submission attempts. What an amazing unification bout between two world-class martial artists, two bantamweight world champions. Who is going to leave Singapore with the strap? Michael Cervello.
Chatri Singh is on the Founder of One Championship to present the belt to the winner. Will it be Kevin Belingon? Will it be Viviano Fernandez? Wherever you're watching live in 138 countries, live and free on the One Super app, how do you score it? Does Belingon claim his 20th career victory? Does Fernandez get his 23rd? Does Belingon stop the streak of Fernandez, the winning streak that dates back to 2011?
Ladies and gentlemen, after five rounds of battle, we turn now to the judges' scorecards. Judge number one calls this bout in favor of the red corner. Judge number two scores this bout in favor of the blue corner. And judge number three calls this bout in favor of your winner by split decision. And now, the undisputed one bantamweight champion of the world, Kevin.
Champion Saruta. A crucial striking of Joshua Pacio. Pacio, the former world champion. Saruta, the one world champion, and Shuto world champion. Right there from Saruta. Switching stance between the Fox and Southpaw here.
That's the low leg kicks of Joshua Pacio. He says he wants to attack that lower part of the leg and start kicking the calf of Saruta.
Now Mitch, Saruta isn't using that awkward, strange 90-degree angle guard we saw him use last time. Oh, throw it back there! Smack back in the guts from Joshua Pacio!
Nice spinning back kick from Joshua Pacio. You're right, Michael, he's not utilizing that guard, but again, that's more the mind games coming from the ninja. Doesn't want to utilize that guard, but I do think we'll see it later on in this matchup.
Saruta, outside leg kick, overhand right again there from Saruta. Chance went up for Let's Go Pacio here in Manila.
Nice duck under to a double leg from Saruta as he ends up in half guard.
Pacio receiving instructions from Mark Sangiao in the corner here from Team Lakay. Half guard position for the champion.
Saruta's got his head wrapped around, or his arm, his left arm wrapped around the neck there. He's trying to get past his half guard position, Joshua Pacio. There's a choke he's got. As long as Joshua Pacio holds the head in that position.
Look for finish. Under 3 minutes remaining, first round set for five for the strawweight world title. Referee Kim Chung right on top of the action. If Pacio can win the title back, the wall of Angel Arena will melt down. To the their feet. Inside leg kick here from the champion. Oh, the high kick! Tried for the headache maker. Did Joshua Pacio.
Joshua Pacio's going headhunting early. He's already tried to go upstairs a couple of times now.
Big hello to all our fans watching on ABS-CBN Sports in action here in the Philippines on Abima TV in Japan. Skips forward the champion. Doesn't commit though. There's a left hand from Saruta. Inside the Royal Basel Arena when they chant Pacio's name. All the team of guys, former champions are here. Folayang, Belingon, Eustaquio. Also in attendance, circle side, the world's heavyweight champion, Philippine star Brandon Vera. So many luminaries have turned out in force for this night of nights in Filipino martial arts. The ball's at his feet again here, Saruta. Inside leg kick from the champion. Still Mitre filling out process from both of these two competitors.
You know, they're still kind of just, you know, there's not a lot of...
Oh, big smack bang! A big kibosh from Saruta. And Pacio on the canvas, and he's back down.
That's the end of the filling out process, I assume.
Saruta's got some confidence flowing now. Tip off the mountain.
Back about it. This is where Saruta's got to create a little bit of space. I'd like to see him frame off the head and start pushing the head down. There he goes. Good scramble by Joshua.
Pacio back to his feet. The crowd appreciates that. Let's see the loose response now with Pacio. And he beat the champion to the strikes.
The first match happened about 13 weeks ago, so that's not a lot of time to make a lot of improvement. But what you can do is you can get in better shape and also figure out your game plan. Whoever can implement their game plan. Tonight is
going to
be the one
who
walks with that
belt. Moving punches from Pacio. 20 seconds remains. Good check there from Saruta. And Saruta turns in there. The mind games from the Japanese world champion.
Right hand there. Is that what he's doing?
Trying to get inside the head of Pacio. Pacio. Jumping roundhouse kick off the lead leg. And Saruta looks like a tree earlier on with that big punch.
Joshua had some early success here as he spins and goes right to the body with a beautifully timed, but then Saruta was able to answer right back with that right hand. Boom! Right on the button. Puts Pacio down. And then he was able to get on top and do a little bit of ground and pound. Joshua did a good job, though, of keeping Saruta nice and tight, getting his, clearing his head, and then getting right back into the match. Very interesting first round. Or should I say sixth round?
Joshua Pacio looking to reclaim the title. The man left of screen took from him. Instructions from Mark Sangiao and Eduard Folayang in the corner of Pacio. Sold out inside the mighty Mall of Asia Arena in Manila, the Philippines, for one championship Roots of Honor. Ready. Turned out in their thousands for this one, the strawweight world title. Will it be a Filipino victory? Good two-punch combination off the bell there for Pacio. Switching stance, Saruta. KG veteran. All the tricks in the book, and then some that aren't even written in the book. Pacio looks to get airborne with that knee, but didn't commit to it, didn't have the distancing.
That's it.
Saruta inside leg kick. High kick from Pacio. He's enjoying that high right roundhouse tonight. Hasn't really found success with it, though.
He was expecting to throw that roundhouse kick off of the awkward guard shown by Saruta, and Saruta hasn't shown him that guard yet. Again, more of that veteran mind game move as Pacio.
Spinning back fist from Saruta, a counter punch. Pacio accidentally struck the back of the head. Apologies there. Good sportsmanship. Media attention on this bout, on this entire card, has been crazy. Our media conference at City of Dreams earlier on in the week was a record attendance summit. 500 plus media members, the biggest in history. All over the news and Team Lakay athletes appearing on CNN Philippines earlier this week. Outside leg kick there from Saruta. Manila really is a hotbed for one championship. Indeed, this entire combat crazy nation love one championship, especially when it comes to town. It was in Saruta's town a couple of weeks ago in Tokyo. And Folayang saw the title lost against Shinya Aoki, who put him to sleep in the first round. And in the order, Team Lakay's titles were gone. It's now the responsibility of Pacio to win one back for the men from Baguio City.
Good movement shown by Saruta, but soon as Saruta stopped and got a stationary stance, that's when Pacio spun and landed another spinning back kick. I think this movement's kind of got Joshua Pacio a little bit confused here in the second as he marches forward and throws a big right hand there from Saruta.
Haven't really seen Pacio open up with his wushu, with the striking, the combinations. Has had some acrobatics, turning back kicks and jumping roundhouse kicks. Nothing that's landed effective telling blows so far. Another agonizingly close rear leg roundhouse kick. Left hand elbow right there by Saruta.
Saruta closes that distance incredibly fast with that lightning fast footwork, how he's in and out of there. And Pacio seems to have a hard time getting into the rhythm.
Lots of angles being cut here from Saruta.
Like that strategy employed by Saruta, not to stay still, he ducks under a big head kick there.
Certainly, Pacio is going for that head kick time and time again. And there's the first show of that strange forearm guard that Saruta did last time that confounded Pacio. Oh, overhand right from Saruta, tried for the counter.
Pacio said he didn't want to spin as much as he did in the first time, because you can start to see that Saruta started to time that, started to step to the outside right as Pacio was spinning. And that's the same mistake that Folayang made with Nguyen. Nguyen saw it coming over and over again, and he started to step to the side. And then what happened? Boom, a big overhand right that caught Folayang mid-spin. Pacio's got to be careful with the spinning.
Inside leg kick there from Saruta, which went high on the thigh, but do you think that both men are holding back a little here? We haven't really seen them put the foot down to gas it.
Well, in the second round, they're still trying to get a bearing on each other. I don't think Pacio expected Saruta to A, come out in this stance, be this mobile, and I think the Saruta is a little bit surprised at the inactivity coming back from Pacio, because Pacio said he did not want to wait, he did not want to hesitate. Last 10 seconds
of a break off there from Saruta. Final few seconds of this round. I kick from Pacio. Two rounds down, set for five. Strawweight world title on the line. Saruta versus Pacio from inside the Mall of Asia Arena in Manila.
Second round was more of a feeling out process than the first round. We got to see that big right hand from Saruta in the first and a couple of spinning back kicks throughout the course of this match so far coming from Pacio. But what kind of changes are we going to make? I'd like to see Pacio start attacking that lower leg, slow down the movement of Saruta, just start hammering on that calf, which is something he said he wanted to do. Start putting the punches in the face of Saruta. I like how Saruta in the first round was mixing things in with the takedowns. I'd like to see him throw hands, close that distance, and start at least giving Pacio something else to think about besides just the striking. Get into his head a little bit more. Throw those takedowns in.
Come here.
Third round of five. Wherever you're watching, in 140 countries around the world, we hope you're enjoying it. It's one championship, Roots of Honor.
Ready?
Kim Chang had the same concern we did, and he urged the guys to show a little bit more activity in the third round.
Jab from Saruta. Nice kick from Pacio, just tucked under the left arm. Thrust out the jab is the Filipino. Body shot, stuck it well, belly button through the back.
Pacio likes that technique. He likes to go high with the roundhouse and then follow it up with a spinning back kick. He was able to drop Roy Deliguez back in 2017 in the second round with a beautiful spinning back fist off of that roundhouse kick.
Let's see if Pacio can work those wushu kicking skills of his. Lots of movement here from Yasuke Saruta. Saruta, the current world champion. Pacio, the former world champion. And right there from Pacio.
Saruta is still the owner of the biggest punch so far in this match with that big overhand right that happened in the first. Nice leg kick there by Pacio.
Big punch combination from Pacio. Backs off Saruta.
You start to see the superficial damage on the lower boot leg of Pacio. It's starting to welt up there from that one kick. There's Saruta mixing things in with the takedowns. Skip the takedown. Now he's trying to pass the guard. Nice elevation there from Pacio to get back to his feet.
Crowd momentarily thought that Pacio had a choke locked onto the champion.
But I like the strategy from Saruta, mixing the takedowns. Get Pacio thinking about that. At least start fearing it so he doesn't start to throw, so he doesn't get so comfortable with the stand-up.
Pacio fainting. So too Saruta. Razor thin, this world title matchup at the moment. Angles again from Saruta, the cagey one. Pacio tried to counter. Inside leg from Saruta. Good jab, no right hand for company though. Turn back in, look at the liver of Saruta. It's a Team Lakay specialty.
Sure.
Impact the liver.
Final warning.
Very large target. Just to the right of the stomach there. Impacted Vegas North and pulled down the entire body. They say one of the most painful ways, if not the most painful way to get knocked out, is with a liver strike. Particularly a liver punch here, driving the knuckles up in between the 9th and 10th ribs. But the turning back into the liver will do just as well. Overhand right, the cranium cracker there from Pacio. Just needed a little bit more mustard behind it. Outside leg kick. Now Pacio starting to land some heavier strikes, Dragon.
He is, he's starting to put together those kicks, a little bit more of the punches as well. He's throwing combinations, he's getting a little more comfortable.
Oh, spinning though. Man.
That time Saruta was able to step to the side of it. He's starting to see it coming. The problem is when he steps to the side, he's able to avoid it. But when he goes back, he tries to ride the wave of that kick to it, to kind of take away some of the pressure from it. I don't think it's hurting him so much, but it's scoring in the mind of the judges. And also the score sheets.
1:15 remains. Don't forget we are scoring an overall bout, not round by round, under these one championship global rule sets. High kick again from Pacio. Saruta leans back in evasion. Left hook from the champion.
Round off very effectively, and then he's kind of gotten slowed down as the matches weren't on, but Pacio is not really doing as much as I thought he would do either. He's landed a few beautiful side kicks, and that's really been the most significant strike of this round. I do like the takedown of Saruta.
Overhand right there from Pacio. Inside leg goes Saruta. Final seconds of the third of five. Two more rounds to go here in Manila for the one strawweight world title.
Man, man. These guys have been in the ring, the circle, for 40 minutes together. They have a really good read on what to expect. And so they know each other very, very well. So don't get caught too much in the slow action. But we're seeing a lot of very technical details starting to inch forward, especially now that we hit the championship rounds again. This is round, essentially, this is going to be round 9 between these two. I'd like to see Pacio do more of it, be more active, start throwing those hands, start putting the pressure on Saruta, back him up. I want to see Saruta mix in more takedowns, start throwing a little more heat with the punches, backing Pacio up and then shooting him for those takedowns. Very close match so far.
You see the ice being applied there by former world champion Eduard Folayang. 130 martial arts world champions in the one championship roster. Two of them in the circle at the moment. Let's see for some more pepper, some more get up and go here. Saruta body punches here from Pacio. Saruta turns him around against the fence and drives the corking knees into the thighs. So Pacio turns the champion.
Saruta places the hand there on the knee to stop any retaliation from the knees from Pacio.
Shot from Pacio, got in quick, got out even quicker. High kick from Saruta. Pacio trying to stab himself in center circle here. Cross up the jab. Saruta does have some damage under the right eye, courtesy of that lead hand of Pacio. Calf area of Pacio, courtesy of the leg kicks from the champion. There's another one. Fourth round of 5. Jab to Pacio. Again, Mitch gets in quick and scores, gets out.
This is the Pacio we expected to see. Most of those fast blitzes. Bop, bop, in and out. So we're just kind of getting hypnotized by it. Now he's starting to come forward.
Mitch, if the match was stuck right now, who would you have ahead?
And after the first round with the knockdown, beautiful kick there from Saruta. Landed on Saruta. That big first round knockdown. But now I'm starting to see in the second, third round, Pacio starting to inch forward. I think he's more aggressive. I think the striking superiority is there.
Counting from Pacio. After a really nice left hook from Saruta, under 3 minutes remains. Penultimate round of action here. Certainly seeing some heavier artillery being launched now by both of these world champions.
In the first match, we did not see Saruta do a kickboxing match with Joshua Pacio. He was going for takedowns. He was mixing things up. He was inside the clinch, wearing on Pacio. Now, all he's doing now is just striking with him in the last couple rounds. But to answer your question, if the match was stopped right now, I might give a slight edge to the Team Lakay athlete.
Back
scenes here in Manila. My word, a highlight reel KO. Here's Dom Lack.
To present the belt for this match, we have CEO and President Philippines of Holcim, Mr. John Stone. And now, ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Mr. Kemp Cheng, has called a stop to this contest after 2 minutes and 43 seconds in the fourth round for your winner by way of knockout!
One championship at the Singapore Indoor Stadium. Great crowd, very noisy. This is what they came for. Right hands from Folayang early on, wanting to land those big punches as soon as he can before Aoki can get to grips with him.
Immediately, Aoki comes open-handed, no strikes thrown, gets into the clinch, and it is no surprise that he wants this fight as quickly as he can to the ground.
Strong man for Lyon, tough to get him to the ground. He'll rely on technique, just as he did there. Now, how good is for Lyon's submission defense? And can he get back onto his feet where he'll be more dangerous?
Aoki is so strong from these positions. Once he gets those hands on you, it's just like he has the clasp, like he's just magnetized to your body. He keeps such tight pressure in every inch that he slides his body, that he easily passes into side control, laces the hands. He's got deceptively long limbs. He's got a great reach, and he easily slides around. Nice, but he jumps onto the back of Folayang. They're dry too, there's no sweat on the body, so it's a lot harder to slip out of these positions. Folayang is very explosive. He likes to burst into positions, but Aoki's dry, so he's clinging onto the back like a koala bear.
They're directly above us here at cage side. Good strength from Aoki.
Armbar, possible armbar here. It looks like he's going for it. It looks like he's setting up a Kimura now. Taking the back, he uses it to hold onto the position. Now he's got the back and the body triangle.
Folayang will have trained for these kind of positions intensively over the past few weeks.
Yeah, but you just don't know if he has the caliber of grappler out there in Baguio like Shinya Aoki.
I think it's inevitable that he doesn't have it. This is the real thing. This is the biggest test for him.
And even if he does have great grapplers in his camp, they're not going to be able to emulate the style that Aoki has. He's so unique, he's so versatile, and he's so different, he's so creative. Nobody in the world is like Shinya Aoki.
This fight being beamed to 118 countries around the world. Tremendous level of interest in this contest. The flagship of one championship in many ways, Shinya Aoki.
Let's go.
Mitch, you've fought and grappled with, trained with Shinya Aoki before. You haven't fought him as such, but you've trained with him so many hours. Just how tough is it?
Yeah, Steve, I've spent hours on the mat with this guy, and I don't last very long. I don't last as Edward's doing a great job, and he's able to slide out.
And he's back on his feet, and that's where
impressive.
He wants to be. Great impetus for Folayang fans now. What can he do with this opportunity?
That's a victory all unto itself, but now he's going to have to be very careful. Ooh, he jumps into a nice little knee there. He should have circled around and created more space because Aoki immediately goes to the clinch. He's got those hips laced up, so Folayang really can't go anywhere, and he uses a beautiful body lock trip takedown. And now Folayang's up against the cage.
He's okay.
1 minute 30 left of this opening round. Most of it has been on the deck with Aoki in charge. Elbow to the head of Folayang.
Folayang was able to get back into guard, a better position for him. Not as much danger, pushes off.
Great strength again from the Filipino.
Look how tight he immediately magnetizes himself to Folayang, letting him go nowhere.
Thrives on the contact, the Japanese fighter, doesn't he? Doesn't want any space between you and him.
Folayang's doing a good job. He's got to break this body lock. You don't want to let your opponent get double underhooks and get that tight body lock, because Shinya's probably going to end up going to a trip here and drag Folayang back down to the mat. You can see him trying to pick him up, but Folayang maintain a good base.
Five rounds this one, potentially. Don't forget, championship contest.
Judges will score the bout in its entirety and not round by round.
We'll go to Rich Franklin when this one's done to get his thoughts on the first 5 minutes.
Good balance shown by Folayang to because he went for that outside trip there, and Folayang was able to maintain his balance and stay on his feet. And he's actually looks like he's going to get out of the first round after some very dangerous. The entire hush has fallen over the Singapore Indoor Stadium as this packed crowd is just waiting for
Nice trip.
Beautifully timed. Right as Folayang was throwing that knee, Aoki swept that foot out and just scored with another takedown. We can see here's Aoki threatening with a possible Kimura, was able to maintain that position with the Kimura using those long legs to secure the back and just jump on there with that body triangle. It's probably pretty evident how this round has been scored, but let's go to Rich Franklin, just get his opinion on what's happening so far.
Yeah, obviously this fight is all about the ground control. Aoki is taking control with the takedowns. He's controlling Folayang on the ground, but you know, Folayang has showed some glimpses, and this is what I talked about before the fight. He's very unorthodox. He works himself out of weird positions, which is a very difficult thing to do against a guy like Aoki. After all, you've had him on top of you, and you know what it's like. So it's going to be interesting, because Aoki has been pressure, pressure, pressure in the first round, and I wonder if that's going to actually affect his gas tank at all. And, you know, Folayang, he'll stay unorthodox the whole fight, and we're going to see if that actually poses some problems in the later rounds. At this point, if the fight was stopped, obviously Aoki.
We're only 1/5 of the way through this contest as scheduled, though. And those Baguio trainers training at altitude are very, very fit. Cardio is a big deal for them.
Looks like a kick was the first strike that Aoki has thrown this entire fight.
Folayang trying to confuse with movement laterally, side to side, changing direction constantly.
That's what he needs to do.
Really let go with that kick, and there was the familiar spinning back fist. Didn't connect.
He can't help it. He's put himself into a dangerous position when he spins by giving the back to Aoki like that. But he says he can't help it. It's just something that naturally happens. He loves the spinning attacks. That's good, that's good. Looked like it was a possible headbutt to the chin there. Yuji Shimada is warning Folayang about it.
Whenever Aoki shoots for the takedown, he's got to be careful of knees and all sorts of things coming at him, because Folayang would have trained for that. Land those blows when you can.
Good movement. Aoki's trying to pressure Folayang up against the cage. Folayang's got to start moving. He can't let him get that close.
He's an expert at just cutting you off, isn't he, Aoki?
Beautiful corners. Nice defense there from Eduard as he throws off the double leg attempt from Aoki.
Great strength from the Filipino to do that. He's got tree trunk legs, as so many of the fighters in Baguio do. Training in those hills. Tremendous strength in the lower limbs. That was just, just everything was thrown into that. It didn't land, but it nearly knocked Aoki over just with the draft.
I'm liking the lateral movement of Folayang. He's moving really well on his feet. He's just not putting any strikes behind it, so he's not scoring. He's not hurting Aoki, except with these big, scary strikes, which I think I can kind of feel the wind from over here. Oh, nice little knee, but again, he gives himself into the takedown.
It was a very ambitious effort, wasn't it, from Eduard? He was always going to expose himself if it didn't pay off.
High-risk move with huge payoff capabilities, but now he's on the mat with one of the world's greatest.
Approaching the midway point in the second round. One championship, lightweight title on the line. The champion in the white shorts, the challenger in the red.
Aoki's doing the right thing. He's pushing him up against the cage, dropping him with those elbows. He's not only scoring points, but he's also softening up Edward. Folayang's trying to create some kind of space. And that's exactly what he's able to do.
Oh,
but Aoki
he's done
just
well.
Immediately latches onto him.
Back on his feet, Folayang, but
that's
still
it.
Not out of trouble.
It's better than where he was. So that's improvement.
Knees to the body from the Filipino. Ideally, he wants space between the two of them so that he can attack with legs and punches. But these knees to the body will be punishing.
Nice knees from Folayang. He scored a bit there and was able to break away. These might be moral victories for Folayang, but I don't know if the judges score on survival.
Five rounds, it's a marathon, not a sprint. Folayang knows that if he can just keep surviving, the chances will come.
You can see Aoki's not expending any energy. He's completely relaxed into every single one of these positions that he gets into, and Folayang's not landing any strikes that are doing any significant damage to Aoki yet.
Contrastingly, in the stand-up, Folayang expending a lot of energy, lots of lateral movement.
That was a nice little lower leg kick there thrown by Folayang. Aoki acknowledged it well. He was like, yeah, you got me.
Aoki almost static at times. So focused, is he?
He's just waiting for that takedown. You know what Aoki's going to do. He's going to get to the clinch, try to get the takedown, but can you stop it? That's the question. That's the puzzle everybody's been trying to solve in one championship.
Oh, kick to the knee from Eduard. Hard feet, he's got hard shins.
He needs to keep doing that over and over again, attacking those legs, because that's going to limit the movement of Aoki.
The strength of that punch. Aoki backed off. Just hit him in the chest, I think. Oh, but there we go again. Again, it was low. There's the spinning back kick. Getting a bit of momentum now. The kick to the torso. The crowd getting behind Folayang. There'll be plenty of Filipinos here in Singapore. Punch to the body. Is that an area of potential weakness for Shinya? And Eduard Folayang ends the second round on the up and up.
That was a better round for Folayang. He was able to use the strikes and start to open up. And he's really starting to dictate the space. There's that big head kick and spinning back that they just barely missed. Big attempt, good, he stopped the takedown. These are moral victories. These are gonna add to his confidence. You can see Folayang immediately gets into guard, keeps it nice and tight. Rich Franklin, what do you got so far?
Well, I'll tell you, Folayang had a couple takedown defenses in that round. They ended up on the ground, which wasn't a takedown by Aoki. However, Aoki added to his ground control lead. At the beginning of the round, it was really interesting to me because even though Folayang was moving side to side laterally, Aoki was moving in such a way that Folayang couldn't really commit to anything. He couldn't mount any damage on the feet. Anytime he committed, he knew he was going to end up on the ground. But at the end of that round there, you could see that Folayang was moving forward more and more, and Aoki was back. And at the end of that round, you could see that Folayang was landing the strikes. He closed the lead a little bit there, but still, if the fight was stopped at this point in time, Aoki would still have the decision.
I like what you're saying there, Mitch. Little moral victories here and there, confidence boosters for Folayang, just that he can bring forward. Give himself a little bit of encouragement. The attack from Aoki.
There's that flying knee again. That is getting timed very well. But look at this. He's able to shrug.
Oh, and the knee to the head as well. Folayang, he's got Shinya in trouble. Punches to the head. The noise behind me is deafening. Folayang looking for the finish. Shinya Aoki is standing very, very closely, watching hard. Nothing's coming back from Aoki. We're only half a minute into this third round. It's perpetual motion from the Filipino. And it is all over. We have a new one championship lightweight title holder. And his name is Eduard Folayang.
Steve, he did it. Eduard Folayang shocks the world with an upset victory to become the new one lightweight world champion. Quite possibly the biggest upset we've ever had in one championship.
Well, I tell you, there were a few people who could have seen it coming. Rich Franklin, give us your thoughts.
I don't even know what to say at this point in time. It's unbelievable. You know, Folayang had those high-risk moves, the spinning kicks, the spinning, and he actually attempted that jump knee once or twice earlier in the fight. And you knew that if it landed, it was going to pay off for him, and it paid off right there.
You can see from the replay, Aoki offering nothing in return, defending as best he could, but nothing was coming back, and that was the deciding factor in Yuji Shimada's decision to stop the fight. And the tears of emotion, so apparent. It's been a long time coming for Eduard Folayang, but his moment has arrived, and the Philippines are enjoying it just as much as he is.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Yuji Shimada, has put a stop to this fight after 41 seconds in the third round. For your winner and new one lightweight world